Thank you, Craig. Okay. Could you do it? Could you have a job that's adventurous? You get to see the world, in a sense. But you're in a confined area. And you're underwater.
Nope.
Could you work on a nuclear submarine?
No.
Or would that trigger your claustrophobia a little bit?
How long are you down there?
Months at a time.
Have they made them any bigger than they did, say, 80 years ago?
You were on one 80 years ago?
It was 80 years old. It was a captured German submarine. I've told you that before. They had it on display.
We did capture it.
And when I lived in Chicago, and I got on that, and I was at a young age, and I was terrified just getting in there for 10 seconds. I couldn't imagine being in it for months or weeks.
Well, here's a nuclear submarine here, one of Britain's that was out at sea with 201 days without a break.
No way.
Mm.
So, no. Better part of a year there.
I don't think I could do that.
And I read this piece by a guy who served 23 years on submarines. The crew lives in the closest of quarters. There's no privacy. You share food, bathrooms, toilets, and sleeping quarters with everyone. Emotions, of course, become magnified because he says there's the incessant threat of attack or ambush by an unseen enemy. He said, we're always hunting and being hunted. I liken submarine warfare to a knife fight with an unseen opponent in a pitch black room.
Yeah, so plus that.
That's the emotional reality of it, is you feel like you're in a knife fight in a completely dark room, but you can't see who's stabbing at you.
No. I wonder if they have sailors freaking out. How common that is.
He says a single wrong move down there, and even a clumsy sound can be fatal because all these submarines are hunting for each other.
Wow.
In the water. He said that there was one time during, he was only a month into one of his deployments, and he had a close call because these submarines are silent and hunting each other all the time. Sometimes they can almost run into each other. And you go through a close quarters drill at that time. He said sonar operators, they have to get to work reporting the bearing of the other sub. Tactical systems guys go to work doing course and speed stuff. And they're trying to avoid collision. And when collision is avoided, they'll attempt to regain control of the situation because you're in a dogfight at this stage. So it's like Top Gun underwater. And you're trying to position yourself behind the enemy sub.
Wow.
280-foot metal tube, he describes it as. So that's how big this submarine is.
Yeah,
no telling how wide it is.
Yeah, no way. I don't see how they do it.
280 feet long, but if it's only 5 feet wide.
What do they do for exercise? Because they have to stay.
I know it, yeah. It doesn't say in this piece what they do for exercise.
Football.
But in this close quarters drill, he said that they lost somehow their cooling system. So the humidity went to 100% inside the sub, which that's miserable.
Can't breathe.
You can't breathe the water air. And the thermometer hit 60 degrees Celsius. So that's like 42. 3 miles. So... He said the crew starts dropping from heat exhaustion. Some were seriously ill because they're losing guys. They lost like 25 guys who passed out due to the heat down there. And they finally found what was causing the problem. It was barnacles that blocked the coolant inlet pipes on the sub. Yeah, barnacles. So something like that can go wrong down there. There were only two toilets that were working. So they had to use the officers' toilets for 130 men sharing two toilets.
Oh, man.
When everything was working, he says, there were only 9 toilets and 10 sinks on the whole ship. Only 9 toilets, yeah, for all those guys. There were only 3 showers on a submarine.
So no one's showering.
And you can't take a very long shower because the noise can give away the position of the sub because the other subs down there are listening for you at all times. You know, so it's like Hunt for Red October.
What a
which
great
is,
movie.
Boy, I loved that movie. Mm-hmm. That was the so movie good. Where I found out that Russian military people had Scottish accents.
Right.
One ping hungry. Or whatever that accent he has is. Yeah. Is that Scottish?
I guess.
Sean McConnery.
Give me a ping, Vasily.
One ping hungry, Vasily. And also, everything on a nuclear sub is recycled. The air is recycled. The power source, of course, is nuclear. And the only thing that they have to discharge is the wastewater, the black water.
Oh, no.
And they have to discharge that out. But, of course, it makes a noise. So if someone's right on your tail or chasing you or listening for you, you could have backup.
Ugh. Wow.
And when you take a shower, they only turn on the water just long enough for you to get wet. Then they turn it off for you to shampoo and soap. And then the water goes back on just long enough for a quick rinse, and you're trying to hurry up. Because there's no shower. There's no shower that's longer than a minute.
God.
And they say you have to get used to the smell down there.
Yeah, imagine.
Because it's a combination of body odor, roll-on deodorant smell, and then the scorched smell of the engine. The nuclear reactor or whatever that's happening.
I hope those guys get paid well.
Yeah, I wonder how much they make.
Yeah, you would think they would get a bonus for
a big hard tube of semen.
Okay.
What? Yes, it is.
It is.
It is.
Going in someplace so wet.
You're again right.
I mean, that's the military for you.
We get it. We get it.
What? Didn't we know a guy once who served on a submarine?
Mark.
The salty seaman?
I'm trying to remember if the...
Eric?
Yeah, or maybe he was just in the Navy.
I know he was in the Navy.
But I think he may have been on a submarine.
Maybe.
You should make triple the pay, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And then the guys who are out on like an aircraft carrier out at sea, they should make more than the average person who's...
Yeah.
Gets to be on land like regular humans.
Yeah.
I just don't understand how people can go through those conditions. We absolutely are the most adaptable animal on Earth.
Yeah.
How great must they feel after 200 days on that sub when they make it to land and they get some R&R?
Okay, they say that the transition's very weird. This guy talks about how when he would be done with a deployment, he would come out into the regular world and he would feel like a different creature, like he was in a foreign place.
Huh.
Everything was because, really bright.
Well, a few things. Yeah, the brightness is alarming to him. It takes him a while to get used to how bright the world is. The other thing is it takes him a while to learn how to see at a distance.
Oh, wow.
Because your eyes atrophy down there because you're focusing on long range. Your eyes never get to do that down
there. Interesting.
So it ruins your eyesight. And then the other thing he said is that the world seems very chaotic to him.
Mm-hmm.
Because down there, everyone has a job and everything works like clockwork and
very
on
quiet.
Cycles.
Yeah.
And he says he remembers getting out of there, and this guy's in the British military. He says he remembers getting out and being in London. I think he said he's at Trafalgar Square or something. And he couldn't make sense of how everyone's going in different directions. And like he kept having the thought of who's keeping track of all these people. It's just mayhem to me.
Interesting.
It was madness. So there's a Dang. Huge psychological adjustment of getting off a long deployment.
Couldn't do it. What sent you down a submarine?
I don't know. I got to reading. I was like, I want to read about what living in a submarine is like.
Like a yellow submarine?
I want you to do me a favor. Do you have a to-do list over there for today?
I do, as a matter of fact.
Write
yeah.
die as the number one number one task
last
for today.
Or first?
No, no, first.
All right.
Die first and then go pick up the mail.
All right. Got it.
Yeah. A submarine, living in a submarine. Let's at least tour one sometime.
I'm up for
next
that.
Next time there's a nuclear submarine that's at White Rock Lake, we ought to go tour it.
Okay.
Could you even do 8 hours in a sub, George? Like if they said we
no
can
way.
Take you guys out for eight
no.
hours.
No, I would I would do just what Gordo told me to do. I would die. I would clang my head into the metal pipe that was closest to me.
Just to kill yourself.
Yeah.
Could you make an hour?
No.
What about watching the depth gauge when you see that you're like a mile down?
No.
And you hear it start to creak.
Yeah.
No.
All right, Gordo, thank you. That is the ODEC.
Thank you, Craig. This broke on Friday, so we haven't had a chance to talk about it yet, but the royal bombshell that Princess Kate is actually battling cancer, and that's why she had that surgery back in early part of the year, and she had abdominal surgery, and she said that they felt at the time it wasn't cancer, but she has the surgery, and they found cancer then. So she's undergoing preventative chemotherapy, she said in a recorded statement of her sitting out on a park bench outside, and she released this video statement. She's 42 years of age, and she's the future queen.
So we can all put our pitchforks down now and quit demanding answers?
I'm getting to that. She said, most importantly, it's taken us time to explain everything to George, Charlotte, and Louis in a way that's appropriate for them. Those are their children. And to reassure them that I'm going to be okay. You know, King Charles himself diagnosed with cancer just last month, and he's undergoing treatment. And he's visited her a couple times, I think, when she was in the hospital and since. Feels very close to her.
Mm-hmm. King Charles loves the king.
Oh, gosh.
But so did this end all speculation? Well, for some people, it did. By the way, Prince Harry and Meghan, they offered their support to Kate and said, "We wish health and healing for Kate and the family. I hope they're able to do so privately and in peace. And don't forget, we have a new candle line that is going to be released soon. Some exciting new scents that will bring about world peace and healing in this time of reckoning and a much overdue conversation."
Okay.
That's what they said. So Blake Lively is one of the people who was among the first to issue an online apology for a now deleted Instagram post, which was a Photoshop joke inspired by the manipulated Mother's Day photo that Kate had put out, which was digitally altered. Blake Lively said, "I'm sure no one cares today, but I feel like I have to acknowledge this. I made a silly post around the Photoshop fails frenzy, and oh man, that post has me mortified today. I'm very sorry."
As there's a drive in a deep left field by Castellanos, it will be a home run.
And remember, we went through this too with, remember when Chadwick Boseman was losing weight and people were making comments about his weight?
Yeah.
And then, came out that he had colon cancer, and he ultimately passed away from it.
Yeah.
So he'd been battling it for years. Mm-hmm. So he had colon cancer while he was making Black Panther.
Yep.
But those who speculate and then attack are not going to learn their lesson here, that maybe wait for more information.
Within minutes of Kate's announcement on Friday, trolls started spreading
another
post about her video saying it was AI generated.
No way!
They uploaded the video multiple times with different people's faces on it. They did it with Princess Diana making the announcement. They were showing you how easy it is to fake an AI generated post like that. So
we can just do that to anything now. We can just say, no, it's AI.
And people started saying that, where's William? Why isn't he sitting by his wife's side while she's making this announcement? And they get on him for that. So William goes, he'll sit down and be by her side, and then she'll do the announcement again. And then those same people say, why is he sitting there? This is her time. She doesn't need him. She doesn't need a man to make an announcement with her. Yes. I love it that we've entered the can't win of human culture now.
Surely 90%, though, of those who were somehow upset about this thing have thought, oh, yeah, I'll probably jump the gun on that.
I would hope.
You see the related story that there's this somewhat alarming rise in cancer being detected in people under the age of 50.
Yeah. And they particularly colon cancer.
Yeah. Now, they say part of that is environmental, they believe, but also part of that is more screening being done. So we know about it more than we did in the past. But still a little troubling.
Yep.
There was another post that was shared and viewed millions of times. It was a doctor claiming that Kate's statement did not make medical sense. This is another thing now. We can always get doctors. There's enough doctors in the world that you can find some that say and then we see and he's a doctor.
Did he elaborate?
He was asked how cancer could be found after surgery, and he said, with all respect to the royal family, that kind of press release doesn't make a lot of medical sense.
That dog done hunt.
No disrespect.
You can't find cancer after a surgery?
I always thought you could.
Sure.
Yeah, let's say, and we're purely speculating here, so put that. I just want to offer that warning. Let's say that they were going in to take out a tumor in her colon, and they had biopsied it, and it was benign. I thought biopsies, you're only seeing if it's cancer in the place where you stuck the needle.
Yes.
So could there be other cancerous growths around it?
I don't think so.
A false negative? Yeah. I don't know. But you would think of that the Princess of Wales, though, they would have had 50 biopsies on that thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. What do I know? I'm on AM radio, guys.
And FM.
And stream.
And stream.
And worldwide internet stream. Anyway, that was big news. The other big international news. Did you see that terrorist shooting over in Russia?
Awful.
Where those four dudes busted in a concert venue and killed, was it 130 people?
Yeah. 133 is the count right now, and it's probably going to go up.
Mm. And ISIS has claimed responsibility. And the four dudes that they captured, do you think they've been roughed up?
Yes.
Yeah. It's like they've been in a prize fight.
And the Russian authorities are just allowing all this footage and all these videos to be leaked about their treatment of these guys. I mean, there's pictures of one dude lying on what looks like a gymnasium floor with his pants down at his ankles with a car battery hooked up to his genitals.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
I haven't seen that.
Jeez.
There's footage that news organizations have seen, they have not released it, of one of the suspects having his ear cut off and being forced to eat it.
Oh my God.
And this is before the trial, just by the way. This is part of their interrogation techniques. And they all four were taken into the courtroom in various states of, I mean, their faces just swollen beyond recognition. The one dude has, of course, the side of his head bandaged where his ear was cut off. One of the guys had to be wheeled into the courtroom unconscious.
Oh my God. I don't think I feel sorry for any of those four guys if they were the ones that took all those lives, but if one of those guys was just an innocent bystander,
yeah,
how awful is that?
Well, even if the guys did all that shooting, that's not the world that we want in which you're just, you're being like this, that is this savage.
Right.
But good God. Powerball and Mega Millions jackpots are pretty high right now.
What we got?
Combined, they're worth $1.9 billion. So the Mega Millions jackpot grew to $1.1 billion, and the Powerball jackpot is at $800 million right now.
Hmm.
The next Powerball drawing will be today. And if there's a winner, it will be the sixth largest prize in the Powerball history.
Should I play again? Remember,
right?
Remember last time I got around a billion, I played a couple times, but then the last time I didn't because I decided that winning $1 billion would only complicate my life. Like, I'm very happy right now.
Wow.
And the billion would complicate my life so much and probably bring so much stress that I'm not sure I wanted it.
Yeah, but the Muser payout, though, would get Gordo and I out of debt.
You're not thinking of us.
That's right. I promised to give you guys $10,000 each.
Whoa, we're down to 10 now?
Courage.
If you won $1 billion, you would owe us each at least $100 million. That's only fair.
I'll just take $10 million.
He does not.
Okay, I'll take the remainder of his, the extra $90 million he's leaving on the table.
Norm just said I would not owe you. Would you guys, and it's full transparency, the world knows, would you take it right now? $1 billion.
If the whole world had to know that I won?
Yes.
Oh.
Everybody knows.
Yeah, I think you have to, right?
Yeah, bring it on. It's fine.
Now, your life changes dramatically. You have to isolate from all other human beings.
Which you do anyway.
But then again, Mark Cuban, he has $1 billion.
He's doing fine. Right. He owns the Mavericks. Well, he used to.
He seems to have a happy life.
He's got a TV show.
There's got to be a way to do it.
Public all the time.
There's got to be a way to do it.
I mean, I guess you should take the billion and donate all of it to charity if you don't want the stress.
Sure.
So maybe
then
I can do that.
But what you're trying to avoid is people who are just bugging you for money all the time and the security concerns that come with people knowing you have $1 billion or thinking that you have. And those people will think that you did not give it all away.
Right.
You'll never escape that stuff.
I'd hire a security team like Dion that have shirts that said F around and find out.
Okay.
Get your own theme music whenever you walk into a room.
Yeah, get some theme music. Absolutely. Yeah, give me $1 billion.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right.
I'll deliver. It'll be funny.
Yes, I would take $1 billion. You're crazy to turn it down.
You?
Yes.
Who for 30 years have said you wouldn't want
man.
That.
I don't know, man. I don't know about
that. Now you're going to take it? For 30 Radio years, Superstar. You don't want everyone knowing that you've got $1 billion. The security
risks, I've changed
risks,
a lot in the
that.
Last 5 minutes, and I don't think you're recognizing that.
And you have every right to change. I just find that interesting that you would take it.
People said goodbye to the Fort Worth Zoo's baby gorilla. That cute little gorilla that we've seen on the news.
They've traded
Jamila. She's going to a zoo in Cleveland.
What did we get back in this trade?
I don't know. I don't know how zoos work, but her mom rejected her.
Oh, it's terrible.
So Norm says we got an elephant back in the trade.
Well, he knows. He keeps up with the draft and trades. And...
But there were lines around the world to see Jamila before she left at the Fort Worth Zoo. She's 11 weeks old, and she was delivered by emergency C-section, and I guess that zoo staff had to care for the baby for a little while, and then when they tried to give it back to its mom, the mom said, that's all right. She had her own life going on.
Yeah, she
didn't want the complication.
Just like a mama bird, if you touch the baby bird.
That's old wives used to say that a lot. But so the zoo staff tried to train another adult female gorilla to be the substitute mother to Jamila, but that was also unsuccessful. So now she got traded to Cleveland for future elephant considerations.
Cleveland!
Dodge and Chrysler are recalling some vehicles over airbags that can explode. 285,000 Dodge and Chrysler sedans being recalled because certain airbag inflators can explode and hurl shrapnel at drivers and passengers. Now, this is based on 5 cases where the airbags inflated when the vehicles were parked when the inside temperature inside the car got above 120 degrees.
Well, that'll happen down here.
Yeah, certain conditions. But it's 2018 to 2021 Dodge Chargers and Chrysler 300s. So check the recall list and see if yours is on that. And then Chick-fil-A is ending their no antibiotics ever pledge for their chicken. Now, this is because of a shortage, expected supply shortage in chicken. So
we have a chicken shortage?
Huh. Why do we have that?
I don't know. Maybe the avian bird flu or something? Or maybe chickens just aren't doing it like they used to. Maybe they have lower sex drives just like humans seem to...
Yeah, I wish we knew.
...be not doing the evil stuff as much to each other.
Why is there a chicken shortage?
Why is chicken shortage?
Is there any news?
So... they now say they're changing it from no antibiotics ever to no antibiotics
for the most part
that would harm humans ever for the most part.
No, yes. No, never.
They're switching the no, never. They're switching that.
Says because of electricity price hikes, labor shortages, and limited wheat supply, which is the main chicken feed ingredient.
Chickens eat bowls of cream of wheat.
I guess.
Yeah, I love cream of wheat. And wheat chex.
You like that?
Wheaties.
Oh, man. I never could stand that.
Chex are what, great. What corn was chex, the, wheat chex.
What was the food that was, it was some kind of wheat-based thing, but they'd serve you little pillows of wheat in
mini
the
wheats?
Cereal bowl? Mini wheats.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, my dad loved those. I never could eat them.
It's like you're eating little hay bales.
Yeah, I felt like a farm animal if I was eating it.
Birthdays today. Gene Shalit is 98.
Wow.
Oh, I didn't know he was still with us. But happy birthday.
James Lovell, the former astronaut who Tom Hanks played in Apollo 13. He's 96.
Whoa.
Is he the oldest guy that went to the moon?
Who's still with us?
And back?
Gotta be.
Gloria Steinem is 90 in her day. Paul Michael Glaser from Starsky and Hutch is 81. Elton John is 77. Bonnie Bedia, the actor, 76. She was in Die Hard 1 and 2. And also that Harrison Ford movie. Was it Presumed Innocent? What was it?
I think that's correct.
It's a good movie.
Okay.
Her at the end is all creepy. I did it. I fooled them all.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
What movie was that? Mary Gross, 71, from SCT. No, Saturday Night Live. Marcia Cross. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. She's turning 62 from Desperate Housewives. Sarah Jessica Parker, 59. Big Sean, the rapper, 36. Ali Machalka, 35, from Easy A, actor, singer. Jeff Kunkel, 62. Avery
Ranger
Johnson,
shortstop.
59. We got a number for him at 840 today.
Mm-mm. Avery's 59?
Yep. Tom Glavin, 58.
Greatness.
Dixon Edwards is 56.
Wow.
Oh,
boy. We need to face the North.
Dixon Edwards.
Did he play it? Where did he play? Michigan?
Michigan State.
Michigan State.
Michigan State. Yeah, that's right.
Danica Patrick, 42. Tristan Hill, 26. And who would have been, I don't know how old today.
90-something, 100?
Yeah. Jack Ruby.
Big day for you.
This is his birthday. That's not a big day for me, sir.
I tell you, the Longhorn Ballroom has his old safe. And no one knows the combo.
Hold on a second. I just need a moment. What?
Longhorn, I told you that.
Yeah, they have an old safe with the Jack
Ruby's.
Yeah. Because he used to own that place or run it or something.
He used to, yeah, do his business down there.
I remember reading about some band who went and...
Sex Pistols?
Played Longhorn Ballroom?
They did.
Did they get in Jack Ruby's safe?
They tried.
Huh. Interesting. All right, we'll have to chase that down. Thank you, George.
By the way, James Lovell is the oldest living astronaut at 95. Frank Borman was a few months older, but he passed away.
The Riddler.
That was Frank Gorman. Frank Borman passed away, Gordon, back in November. We lost an American hero.
4 months ago.
So now it's James Lovell. All right, that's Muse. But first, with Cowboys owner and GM Jerry Jones talking to the media yesterday at the NFL league meetings in Orlando, he had some things to say that made headlines. So he joins us now on the Ticket Hotline from Orlando to talk about those things. Good morning, Jerry.
Good morning, man. How are y'all doing?
Good.
Did you like that uncomfortable interview I wasted your time with at the NFL annual league meetings? I hope you did.
Well, yes, and that it gave us more to talk about, but no, and that I'm not sure we agree with a lot of the things you said.
Did you like that picture that the newspapers ran of me in that hotel lobby giving that interview? Me looking all Stephen Hawking-like the way I'm sitting on that couch there.
Making your notes and the NFL notepad. Yeah.
I did, George. I had my notepad there taking football notes. I was writing stuff in there like, do football good. Do more money. Here are some breasts. And then I draw two circles with dots in the middle.
Oh, okay.
No, I had a to-do list there that I was working on. It said to do, win Super Bowl.
Yep.
Number two, kill litigants. Number three, cut back on drinking.
Okay.
Number four, start drinking again.
Oh, no.
That's what was on that notebook. And then I drew a picture of Dak with money coming out of his pockets watching the Chiefs winning the Super Bowl on TV.
Well, you know, you're getting a lot of questions about the fact that you've lost six starters, but you haven't really replaced any of them. You haven't done anything in free agency.
Well, we're running into money issues there. It's very difficult to spend money on players when one player seems to be making about 40% of the money.
Yeah.
And of course, I'm talking about Dak. Uh-huh. I'm expecting Dak to play a few more positions in quarterback this year.
Where are you going to put him?
I'm going to put him all over the place.
Yeah.
If I'm paying him that much money, he better play more than just one position. Because we can't hire guys because of him.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, that's the way it is, though, in the NFL.
Now, I do think that there are many quarterbacks that have not won a Super Bowl who will win a Super Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Dak is one of them. He just ain't going to do it with us.
Okay, I didn't hear that part.
Yeah.
That's the part I said under my breath that the reporters didn't hear. But we're doing very important things to these NFL league meetings. We're changing kickoff rules.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's kind of confusing, that whole thing. Could you explain that for us?
I can, but I won't. But I will now and before. Well, the way it works is that only the kicker and the returner, uh-huh. Return man, only they can move before the ball hits what I like to call and what others have been calling the action zone, the zone of action.
Uh-huh.
And those players will then, as they move about the field, a way that is that they move, and it is that we have when we are looking at how to betterment the game.
You're trying to make it safer.
We're making it safer.
Yeah.
And for the not only for the football players that we have,
right,
but also the our players. So
okay,
we're calling it the strawberry short kick. Jerry Jr. named it.
Okay.
Right. We'll look for that as a rules change.
You know, my kids get a kick out of when they get to do things like that, so he named it. And
well, that's sweet.
My new half kid, she's causing me trouble, Veruca. She's wanting another Range Rover now, and
gosh,
she ran the other one without oil for about 2 years, burned up the engine.
Yeah, they'll do that.
She's your full kid, by the way, full kid.
Got to get her. That's unproven. But you know, got Mike McCarthy out here with me.
Yeah, the coaches are out there.
He's out here with me. He's been working hard. He's trying to beat Andre the Giant's world record of a 16-second continuous fart.
That's the world record?
Good for him.
So that's what he's working on. He's been carbo-loading, doing all that stuff. He's gotten pretty close a few times. I'll give him credit.
Has he?
In fact, one time Harbaugh hit under a desk yelling earthquake.
Oh, man. Which one? They're both in the league now.
Yeah, well, that's right. We got double Harbaugh. And Steven and Jerry Jr. are here with me.
Oh, they are? Yeah, what are they doing?
Well, it's my weekend with them while Gene and I are trying to work things out.
Oh, oh gosh, no. Don't say that.
Well, George, you have an extra kid. So, yeah, your wife thinks about that.
Understandable there, yeah.
Yeah, you got me there.
But they're up here with me. They got the adjoining hotel room, and they're still asleep right now. I don't want to wake them up because they just require so much of my attention.
Right.
I mean, they're real happy they got their own beds in there. But I've had to get on to them multiple times. They've been stealing all the ice out of the machine. They bought four adult movies on the TV. Having to argue to get them charges taken off because Gene will blame me.
Right.
Right. She'll think it's you.
But yeah, I got them up here.
Kids do love hotels, don't they?
They love them. Hey, did you see the all coaches picture yet?
Yeah, I have seen that. Yeah.
Looked pretty good. Of course, McCarthy looked like an idiot and confused. Kind of like our Green Bay Grant game plan was. Trying to keep them with the theme.
It's cool to see all the coaches together, though, in one photo.
Yeah.
It was. I was taking a Sharpie and circling the ones I wish I had instead of him. About 10 of them. I remember when Chan was here, he did the old coaches picture. He was in overalls and a straw hat, and he was carrying a sheep.
Wow.
Carrying a sheep.
Yeah, I was so embarrassed. That picture always looks like a bunch of men showing up to the 30-year high school reunion, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, a little bit.
A bunch of bald and heavy-set guys. But we have fun with it.
Well, we do. Yeah, we're going to go next year. This thing sounds like fun.
Yeah, we are invited. Come on up.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe y'all can share a room with Steven and Jerry Jr.
Oh, that'd be great.
They'd love it. They'd get bunk beds with you, and now y'all could play the Legos and all kind of games.
Legos.
Good morning.
All right, see ya. There goes Jera from Orlando.
That's what they have at the league meetings, Legos.
Legos. Yeah, I guess so. That does make sense.
Funny name, Twitter handle Joey Freshwater responded to us and said that he's not a Mulkey fan. But this writer that's writing this supposed hit piece on Kim Mulkey Roberts or just
he's
Mulkey?
Just Mulkey.
Indeed. It's very tough. Says this writer definitely has a past with LSU. He's a South Carolina grad and a good friend of the South Carolina women's basketball coach, Mulkey's biggest rival. He has a past of hating LSU and posting about it.
Plus, he writes for the Washington Compost.
Do we have some of Mulkey talking again? I want to hear that voice again. It's always...
Former players have told me that the Washington Post has contacted them and offered to let them be anonymous in a story if they'll say negative things about me. The Washington Post has called former disgruntled players to get negative quotes to include in their story. They're ignoring the 40-plus years of positive stories that people or they have heard from people about me. But you see, reporters who give a megaphone to a one-sided, embellished version of things aren't trying to tell the truth.
Yeah. And George declared her as the hottest woman in the world outside of Hillary Clinton.
No. It ain't going to work, buddy.
No. No.
You did say that she was hot. You had a thing for her.
I don't think I used the word hot.
What word did you use?
Hot. I think like 20 years ago when we could say things like this, that she was attractive. She's an attractive college
that is
basketball.
Offensive.
Mm-hmm.
Said it 20 years ago.
Why is she... Because she had the mask thing. She had the Brittany Griner thing. Remember when she was doing the press conference with the mask and kept messing with it the whole time, putting it up over her eye and then putting it down lower chin?
I don't remember that.
Yeah, it was like this whole...
thought the mask...
She hated
stupid.
The mask thing, and mm-hmm. and but the way she expressed it was the funny part. But yeah, then the Brittany Griner comments, and it just feels like she's trying to be the female Bobby Knight.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can see that.
Reed tweeted out, I had a very weird breakfast this morning, and it made me think of y'all's weird breakfast talk in the past. Like whoever it was that had Funyuns and Yoo-hoo every morning. Okay.
That was Falwell, wasn't it?
No, the Funyuns and Yoo-hoo was a reference to me as a kid.
Oh, okay.
Because I loved Yoo-hoos and Funyuns. And so that's always what I'd get on road trips.
Falwell was something like a Dr. Pepper and a Snickers every morning.
His was, I think it was Dr. Pepper and Munchos.
Or was it a payday?
Yeah, his payday was in there too somehow. God, my brother loved Munchos. He would always eat a bag of Munchos. He would get Munchos, and I'd get Funyuns. And my sister would get Cool Ranch Doritos. None of those are natural foods, by the way, in case you're wondering if those are from the Funyun plant.
I think
or
we
the Cool Ranch Dorito tree. No, that's not where they grow.
When Mark did tickers for us, I think we looked in there and asked him one morning, what are you having for breakfast? And he said, Dr. Pepper and a payday.
Heck, Deucey's had some weird stuff because he always mixes things with Mountain Dew.
He likes Mountain Dew.
But he says he's quit, you know, since he's had a few heart issues. I think the Dew is known for having lots of caffeine.
I thought the Dew was big in West Virginia, not Iowa.
It is. Yeah, West Virginia is like, they put Mountain Dew in baby bottles out there in West Virginia. But Reed is referencing the old Dunham & Miller breakfast packs. I used to go out in the Ticket Hummer. We had a Humvee as a promotional vehicle, and I would go out in that, and I would have wireless broadcast equipment, and I'd park myself at a gas station, and P1s could come by and line up. And I was running like a food pantry, except I would deliver them Dunham & Miller breakfast packs. And it'd always be an odd mixture of real gas station cuisine. It was Yoo-Hoos and Funyuns.
Yeah.
Or you'd get a chocolate soldier and a Mars bar. Just so bad
Maybe
for you.
Bring them back.
So many people sent me this over the weekend. There's apparently a Twitter handle, Zillow Gone Wild, where they post all the wild stuff, you know. Because
oh,
it is
this.
Funny when you see MLS listings and the things sometimes in people's homes give you pause. Like, I remember one time there was a, in the main bedroom, there was a four-poster bed.
Poster bed?
It should be post bed.
Yeah.
Wait, what?
Should be a four-post bed.
And it had shackles hanging from each post, where I guess that's where the couple would get freaky.
Hey, now.
Like chains and shackles, cuffs. Yeah, people's red rooms being, it's on the MLS listing, you have to show the whole house.
What's a red room?
Like a spanking chamber. So this made the rounds. You referenced that you saw it, Giorgio. People were sending it to me. It was this dude's home, and in one room he had, boy, and this does look just like me, in one room there was nothing but vintage radios just lining the wall that he had reconditioned, worked on everyone and put them out there. And then in another room he probably had about this looks like about 87 typewriters.
Yeah. And in one of them
fewer
was...
Fewer than Gordo.
And it's fewer than mine, but I have to say, I looked at this picture. I tweeted out that I could name every machine that's in this picture. And that's when I realized I had a problem.
And also, like you, in one of those, is he typing his manifesto?
I'm not typing a manifesto.
Nah.
You make it sound like I've actually written something on the Unabomber's typewriter. I haven't done that. I mean, who even... I have done that.
That's the one thing you successfully bid on at Heritage Auctions?
I didn't bid on it, but I did go and visit it.
It ain't gonna work, buddy.
Hold on, Kim. Craig, you mentioned that your young daughter accused you of wearing a toupee.
Mm-hmm.
I read a piece the other day about how toupees are being worn by more people than you think, and a lot of them young guys.
Really?
Yeah. The toupees have made a big comeback.
And we don't notice them because they're so good?
Right. Because toupees are so good now.
Toupees.
Next gen toupees.
Hey guys, I'm here second in line.
Yeah, I'm
that's
first.
That's all right. We'll talk to you later.
Anyway, they're slimmer, easier to wear, and way more realistic than the old ones that your grandfather used to wear, which were so fake. Oh my gosh. Toupees are so fake. How's Jerry's looking? I think Jerry needs to update his toupee.
You are fake news.
Let's look at this most recent pic of him from yesterday.
Looks okay.
Well, sometimes the hair color doesn't match on Jerry.
Yes, Yeeps. That's my problem with it.
Yeeps.
If you look on the back of it.
He insists on going with a slightly blonde toupee, like a little yellow to it.
Yes.
And if he would just go straight gray, it would look a lot better.
Yeah. He needs a toupee consultant.
Who's the most famous toupee person in the world right now?
Jerry?
Wearer. Is it Jerry or Bill Self?
John Travolta?
Ooh, that's a good one.
Seriously?
He kind of goes without
Oh, yeah, he's very bald. But
he goes without a lot, though, right?
He's got a lot more the last couple of years recently. He's gone straight bald, but he had a number of hair pieces over the last decade.
Wait a minute.
A number?
So when he was up here, he was wearing a toupee?
John Travolta? I believe so.
I thought his head was shaved when he was with us.
Was it?
Is that what it was?
I'll have to look. I took a picture of him. I'll look.
Marv Albert had a bad one.
Oh, man.
That may have also been a weave. Somebody said Bill Self's is a weave also.
It's a pretty good one.
Who was the... not Marv... Sam Donaldson.
Yeah.
That was a toupee, right?
Yeah.
I think so.
His was like plastic. It was just plastered onto his head. Didn't even have individual hair. Just looked like a Kipps big boy up there or something.
Okay, this is stupid.
What?
So I just searched who's the most famous toupee person right now, and Matthew McConaughey popped up. But look at that doctored pic of him bald.
All right.
You can't get any straight answer on the internet anymore.
We talked about submarines in the ODEC this morning. And Daddy gave me some info on the Ohio-class submarines, which are our biggest ones. That they started making these things back in the early 80s. You know, this is during the Cold War. And 81 is when they first set sail. 560 feet.
Whoa.
And I think we got quite a few of them. Of course, they're nuclear powered now. I'm trying to see how wide they are. That's what I want to find out. Oh, I thought it was here. Displaces 18,750 tons. That's a displacement. They're the world's third largest submarines. They're our biggest, but a couple other countries
have bigger ones.
And, of course, these submarines are a huge part of our national defense because there are responders for a nuclear attack.
Mm-hmm.
So they're a big deterrent for nuclear attack because we park these things right off the coast of nations who have nuclear capability who would want to harm us so that we can respond so fast to them. And oh my goodness, that is huge. Looking at this. Nuclear submarines. Does this make you even more claustrophobic thinking about submarines? P1 sent me this. Adding to the craziness of actually being on one of these things, they can go underneath the polar ice cap and stay there for months.
That's crazy.
Whoa.
So if there's an emergency, they can't even immediately surface because they're underneath the polar ice cap.
Could you handle that, George?
No. Oh.
Might make you sweat a little bit.
Oh.
Be prepared for chocolate-based candies to cost you a little bit more over the Easter season. Coca has risen. The price of coca has doubled since the start of 2024. And so has sugar prices. That's gone up, too.
Hmm.
Pound of sugar is about 8% more this year, and it was also up last year. So you're going to be paying more for your Easter candy.
That's what you get with Biden's America. Everything's up.
Did you like Easter when you were a kid, or did you think it was spare?
No, it was my least favorite holiday because it meant having to get really dressed up for church.
It also meant the rebirth
eggs?
From sin and our risen. Deliverance.
As a kid, I wasn't really into that.
You weren't into the theology no. of Easter so much?
I appreciated the chocolate Easter bunny and the Easter eggs, but I did not like getting dressed up because the weather was always getting warmer. It's really uncomfortable. Taking pictures. Hated that.
Plus, when we were kids, the Easter candy was spare.
Yeah.
Spare. I mean, it was long before
it's like bunny money.
Reese's Pieces and all that.
Remember Bunny Money?
Yeah,
those little medallions that were wrapped in foil that would have like a bunny on the front of it. But yeah, it was kind of like a Nestle Crunch. That's what it was in there.
Yeah, but the Chex, the yellow candy,
Peeps.
Yeah, trash.
Peeps are now a huge industry.
Marshmallow eggs, trash.
Gosh, these were all candies that Jesus invented for us to celebrate Easter.
I don't think he okayed.
Yeah, at the Last Supper, Jesus handed out Peeps. All right. Your funny nightmare, Giorgio, a British woman. Gosh, this first sentence takes so many turns. A British woman was gored through the leg by a yak while climbing Mount Everest as she FaceTimed her brother back in the UK.
Oh, gosh.
She was talking to her brother on FaceTime. She sees this yak. She turns the camera to show the yak to her brother on FaceTime, and it charges her, throws her up into the air, sends a horn straight through her leg.
Oh, my God.
Boy, the yak has serious horns, almost like a longhorn.
They are Tibetan cows,
I guess.
That's what a yak is. It's a long-haired cow.
I wish we moo.
It's also known as a grunting ox. Found throughout the Himalayan regions. They rarely attack humans, except when they don't want you on FaceTime. When they get bugged, when you're using your cell phone in a public space, they'll get ticked. They'll charge you. So this sent a horn straight through her leg as she was trying to get to base camp on Everest. Now, she survived. Had to get stitches. But was attacked by a yak. If you had to be attacked by an animal, that's a pretty funny one to be attacked by.
Yeah. Be attacked by a yak.
Tell a good story.
Is that?
My own.
Did
Doing
she
Johnny Carson?
Did she scream yakety yak, don't come back? What?
Go ahead, give him the big speech.
Yeah, give me the big speech.
What's the big speech?
I don't
know.
That
I hate your broadcasting?
Yeah, something like that, or what you want him to do today.
Yes, look at George's to-do list.
Yeah,
okay. Copy his number one.
I have die on the top of my to-do list.
Okay.
All right.
You'll feel bad if I do.
No, I won't. All right, that's the corner.
Get the Steak Podcast at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
Once again, the ticket presents Why Today Doesn't Suck.
Before we do anything, I'd like to sing happy birthday to Mike Mayock. You guys ready? Happy birthday to you.
And now, here are your hosts, Sean Bass and David Mino.
It ain't gonna work, buddy.
Thanks, Cam.
Hello.
258 on the sweet spot. Notre Dame's up 17 on Ole Miss, if you have that recorded at home. Don't want to spoil it for you.
Hey, Dill.
Your bracket's busted.
Let's go, girls.
Is that the beginning of a song?
Yeah, Feel Like a Woman.
Oh. Is that what you're quoting?
So, right?
Is that what you're quoting?
Let's go, girls.
We're going to hear that later.
All right, 258. Here's Hamchester United.
Thank you, Mino. Eatsy's Market and Bakery and GimmeTheVin.com brings you backup Captain Monty.
Thank you so much, Ham. Hear the bad news, Mino, about Euphoria Season 3?
I mean, we knew it's not going to happen. They lost Angus Cloud.
Yeah.
How are they going to do this?
They told them soon, bro.
That one hurt.
We're going to go ahead and scrap this for a while. Y'all can go ahead and move on to
Could they have done the show without Angus?
No, they couldn't
Enos
have.
Angus Cloud.
The anus.
You can't spell Angus without anus.
Did he die of fentanyl?
It's drugs.
Yeah.
Probably fentanyl.
I thought he had prostate cancer.
No.
It's
like you can't make The Wire without Omar.
They did for like the last 30 minutes of the
like 30
series,
minutes of it.
it was great.
Because he's the Omar of Euphoria.
Everyone in Baltimore was
most likable character, has a code, he's misunderstood. He's not gay like Omar. He might be, I don't know.
What if they act like they killed him off or he died of Fenny and then they just got his brother in there?
Well, his brother on the show died. So,
in a police shootout, and he's like 10 years old. He died.
Yeah.
He's firing an AK through a door, and the SWAT team put him down. Yeah.
Great show. Watch it with your kids.
Yeah, it's definitely, you'll love high school.
Sydney Sweeney's in it.
I know.
And her boobs.
Yes, they're separate.
But, yeah.
Great actress.
But she's over 21 playing an underage.
That's what's
person.
Weird.
Yeah, that's kind of weird.
Is there?
She's like 25, and you just have to tell yourself.
A ton of high school sex, but you're like, okay, well,
they're
it's
adults.
Like Greece.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, it'd be like...
Except Kanicki in Greece literally looks 60.
Yeah. Yeah.
Older than me right now.
If you read the IMDb page, there's a little trivia that at one point one of her grandkids had to get moved out of the way during the drag scene.
Yep. Granny, I'm hungry.
Hold on. Here, wear my Letterman jacket. All right, well, they are the Hardline. Corby.
Bob.
And Dave.
Dave.
Today is Monday, March 25th, the 83rd day of 2024. 281 days left in the year. On this date, in the year 31.
Come on.
According to
Jason Terry.
According to the calendar maker, it was the first Easter.
You think the people that lived in year one were like, this is so cool.
This is kind of cool, bros. Like, think about it.
Like, man.
Wait, so was there a year zero?
Yeah.
Yeah. And was that when JC was...
Yeah, that's
so
when...
He died in year zero?
No. He was born in year zero.
What?
And he died in 33?
Okay. He's
so
saying,
they didn't realize
he's saying
in
31.
Year one then that they were in year one because JC was a baby.
But AD is right? After death, right?
Oh, God.
But oh, man.
Death was past zero.
Okay, so death...
Death is zero.
Death is zero, but then they didn't celebrate death until 31 years later.
Oh, so this is like basically
like
when
he was
AD started.
On alive.
Yeah.
He was a past person.
They gave it time.
Like, they're like, too soon. We can't have like a bunny handing out candy.
Yeah, and were rabbits implemented into the day immediately? You know what would really look cool to celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior, or death of our Lord and Savior, and resurrection?
And rebirth.
Right.
Bunnies as apostles.
Rabbits.
Yeah.
Rabbits.
And maybe marshmallow baby chicks that you can eat.
Instead of like, marshmallow peeps, it would be
What do you guys
like
think
Lego
of the
lamb.
Word Cadbury? That was probably pitched early on in an ad meeting.
Yeah. Don Draper.
What do you think about candy that looks like ovum?
Yeah.
With the vent and everything?
Right. And they got big stone tablets of writing it all down on.
Have to
the
put
feather.
The vent on
Wait,
them.
Slow down, slow down.
Yeah.
You need to capture all this
I'm
gold.
Still, I'm still putting my name on here. Hold on. Looks like Jerry's notepad.
So 31 age. Oh.
Probably too far.
Yeah, we're probably going to have to.
And we dumped
Get rid of that
it.
Guy. No. We can do it ourselves now, though.
Oh, that's
that?
The new one. The
yeah, look at it.
Now. Man, that's a nice button.
It's still got that new dump shine on it.
Now I'm the bad guy.
It kind of looks like a side of a pinball machine, those buttons.
Yeah,
just play
it's
some
probably
pinball
similar
with it.
Technology.
Yeah.
I think they took that off a Space Invaders machine.
Yeah. that's why we were at the pinball festival a couple weeks ago to get a new dump button. That was the
It
tradio.
Was the same day, I think.
I feel like we lost out on that. We traded a morning drive remote fill-in for a new dump button. On this date, in the year 1807, British Parliament abolished the slave trade throughout the British Empire.
Greatest.
There was a penalty of 120 pounds per slave introduced for ship captains.
And that ended racism, I do believe.
Yep, right then it
well,
ended.
Well, it's a good thing that we had already declared our independence and won it.
Yeah.
We're like, that didn't affect us.
We got another like 40 years of this, bros. That's what we fought for.
You think that there
it's
were...
It's almost as though they declared independence because they knew that was coming.
Blew my mind, dude. So, Civil War, slaves.
Mm-hmm.
Independence War, also. A lot of fighting. In the year...
Wow. Freedom isn't free, Monty.
I've heard that. In 1943...
Cost $1.05.
97% of all Dutch physicians struck against Nazi registrations.
Greatness.
Lando.
I didn't even want to read that one. It was on here, though. In the year 1961, Sputnik 10... carried a dog into Earth orbit.
Is that Boris Zuzak?
And was, no, he was two, right?
Sputnik 2.
Yeah. Was it Snoopy?
Again, why do we have to just use animals? Couldn't we get like a death row prisoner?
Good grief.
And like knock off, you know, maybe we won't do the guillotine. Well, we're sending
the Unabomber to space.
Yeah.
It'd be pretty cool.
Instead of a nice little friendly bear or this Pomeranian or whatever with a little helmet on, drinking Tang.
They all love Tang.
Oh, like, they look, really dude, do.
It's an initiation. You got to drink a whole packet. In 1973, the Philadelphia 76ers posted the worst mark in NBA history for an 82-game season. That is an asterisk. At 9-73.
That's weird that the 76ers were playing in 73.
Sports!
Yeah.
It's like Jesus like Easter starting before Jesus died.
Yeah.
Same thing.
It's almost as if it's the Philadelphia 1776ers.
Oh.
Whoa.
Remember what they were fighting for then? Remember the old, they got taxed and they were all mad about it?
Yeah.
They had no one over there.
How does Philadelphia fit into all this?
The Liberty Bell?
What was celebrated?
Benjamin Franklin.
In what way?
Paul Revere.
You should have stuck with the Liberty Bell.
Did they celebrate
Rocky?
Christmas first?
That eventually led to Tyrese Maxey.
I think Boston gets Paul Revere.
Sports. In 1995, boxer Mike Tyson was released from jail.
I've been to Paul Revere's house.
Yeah?
Yeah.
It's that still standing?
Paul in...
pretty small.
They all were,
low,
Dave.
Low ceilings.
He was always out riding, wasn't he?
He didn't go out with vaulted ceilings?
And said the British are coming.
Ooh, hold the phones for birthdays later.
Was the tea party in Philadelphia?
The Boston Tea Party?
No, it was not. Okay, it was the Boston Tea Party in Philadelphia. Just tried.
Neither was the Boston Massacre.
They've got the Green Monster.
I get it. They don't have Philadelphia baked beans.
Just measuring Monty's historical perspective.
Old Ironsides.
Big Poppy is a Philly.
I can't.
In the year 2002, TV reality show The Bachelor, hosted by Chris Harrison.
I'm so scared, baby. Yep.
Debuted on ABC.
I'm so scared, baby. I can't kiss you, baby. I believe Chris Harrison got a $20 million payout to just be like, all right, I'll go.
For ruining America?
I'll just watch The Bachelor.
Man,
for being a racist sympathizer.
No. One of them broads was in a...
It was a bad time for our country.
Antebellum...
She was in blackface.
No, she wasn't in blackface. She did a Civil War party in college or something, and dressed up
too far off.
Yeah,
really.
It's about heritage,
saluting the Civil War.
She did a States Civil rights. War. She did a Civil War triple X parody.
Yeah,
I think we filed that up.
That needs
BBC
to be the next Picks
probably.
With Friends payoff. You have to go commit fully to a Civil War reenactment. The winners pick the side. In 2009.
I think they just wanted to have a party where you could have an umbrella that matches your dress and sort of spin it around.
It was as wide as your dress.
A parasol.
Huh.
A sunbrella, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe drive or ride around on a penny farthing. That'd be fun. In 2009.
Or states' rights to have that party.
Right. That's what was important.
They didn't want the federal government to be able to tell them if they could have parties with umbrellas.
Yeah.
Because that would be a clear overreach.
In 2009, dating app Grindr was launched.
Thinking.
Hang on, I got
that. This was a seminal app because it was the first ever dating application to combine dating information and location.
Hmm.
How come it was okay when you said it?
I'm right here behind these bushes.
Homosexual.
Drop a pin for the exact bush you're in. I guess before that, you were hooking up with people in New Hampshire.
Oh, yeah.
Iowa. Didn't matter. It was just a free-for-all. And in 2019,
we were looking forward to the outcome of that.
No, not that free for all.
Ew.
Although, again, probably some crossover there. NASA canceled a planned historic all-female spacewalk because they didn't have enough spacesuits to fit.
They didn't have enough space tampons.
Way to go!
How does that differ from a regular tampon?
They lost all their space parasols.
Yeah,
so they it's all had, the G. They literally had space women space astronauts saying, "I have nothing to wear."
Yeah, once they got up to like G3, they'd come flying out.
Right. Whoop. Today's spacewalk was canceled due to a lack of space tampons.
Yay!
G-force training. We have to wait another week.
Dexter.
Wait till next Monday.
How much longer you say you got? P1 birthdays. Got this one late Friday. Greetings, Monto. Tomorrow is my 30th birthday. My leaders are the Great Donovan, Garbage Time Jub, and Line 4 Guy. I'd love to hear a joke from Line 4 Guy. Hashtag Ragonk from Mervin.
Been a while.
Mervin.
He probably ran out. Doesn't have any more.
Store?
Loved his store. Got some sick billabongs.
You know, my wife the other day asked me how I view lesbian relationships, and apparently in 4K was not the correct answer for it.
Yeah! They got 8K now, bro. You can see all of it.
Oh, bro. I have to update my joke.
Some might say you can see too much. Hey, Monto. Long-time listener, first-time emailer. I know this isn't exactly today's date, but March 24th is a very big birthday in my life, and I'm hoping you could give it a shout-out on Why Today Doesn't Suck. This is the birthday of my best friend, somebody who I spend a lot of time with on a daily basis. Unfortunately, this friend hasn't been able to do much for me in the last 11 years, but even so, I've done my part in maintaining our relationship based on what the first 9 years of my friend's life provided. I spend some time every day with my pal, and my love is unconditional. Yesterday, my best friend, The Office, turned 19 years old.
No.
Thank you for your time, your secret admirer, Sod.
I knew it!
What gave it away, The Office?
Yeah.
Hey, Sod.
I thought it was
man,
the brilliant
I thought somebody
writing.
Was going to die. Like, oh my God.
Yeah, I was going to say, he got me in the first half.
Sod, so it's been on for 19 years, and how many viewings have you given it?
I finished 29 yesterday.
29.
Man. And how many
for
total
Rusty
seasons?
Greer.
Nine seasons.
And you
29
never skip
times.
An episode.
Of course not.
Three times I didn't watch past season 7. Mm. The first three times.
When okay, you, I was going to ask
married,
you about.
Todd?
I was going to ask you your stance on Robert California. It already happened, Corby.
When are you getting divorced?
Congratulations.
Oh, no.
Congratulations, by the way, Sod, for those of us
yes,
who care deeply about your life.
Thank you. She's a fan of The Office, too. So it's all
like
good.
That kind of fan?
No. Yeah, not
no
that
one
much.
Is that kind of fan.
No.
All right.
So have you gotten tired of it? The
no,
show,
the
not
wife?
Your wife.
No.
No. Don't call it it.
Gotten tired of it.
What's your official?
Like 2 months.
What's the official Sod stance on Robert California?
I'm a fan. I think... I came around to it a little bit later on. I wasn't a huge fan.
In the 15th viewing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The
19th, yeah. Sports.
It took a little time for me to get over the Michael Scott departure. But.
Yeah.
But luckily, at
same.
Some point, you knew it was
I'm still
coming.
Not over it.
That all right, sense. Saturday, March 23rd was the birthday of my older brother, Jamie. He's the biggest P1, might I say WIP1 on the planet, stumps down. Drop request, Corby Bragg, I'm a gay man from Brian.
I'm a gay man.
Dear, Why Today Doesn't Suck, yesterday was my dirt day. None of my family or friends listen, despite my best efforts, so I'm left to report my own birthday. I was awakened it in my own, in the most magical of ways. My leaders are not the guy in the next cubicle over, Gordo's Tortoise, the Helpline AI voice, and Van's annual ticket ticker. Thank you for what you do to your bodies, and P1 Kevin. Birthdays today, turning 77, Elton John. Turning 59, Sarah Jessica Parker.
Good friend of mine.
Horse face. Yeah. Lee Pace, 45. Nate Bargatze, 45.
Funny.
Friend.
Clean comedian.
Jenny Slate, 42. Mona Lisa Saperstein.
Not clean comedian.
From Parks and Rec. Comedian Chris Redd from Saturday Night Live and Pop Stars, 39.
Oh,
Big Sean.
Guy. Black dude.
36.
He's in New York today.
Turning 29 today. Aria Alexander, who was in 217 films,
I'm
like
familiar.
Twerk It, Lil Sis.
Mm-hmm.
Too Tight for Words.
You get nervous, and so you can't talk.
Like, oh my God.
Yeah.
And Daddy, you're ruining changer. My party.
Yeah, he always does.
Tom Glavine.
Too Tight for
Wait,
Words.
Wait, is that a picture right there?
Yeah.
Let me see if I need to bookmark this.
Take a gander. Tom Glavine's 58 today.
Okay.
Avery Johnson, 55.
I have a new search term when I get home.
Yeah. Well, this is the first time, I think, in two weeks we've had someone that's not like 63 years old.
I know.
Avery Johnson, 55. Cheryl Swoops, 53.
Five.
Vladimir Klitschko, 48.
Vlad.
GoDaddy's own Danica Patrick, 42.
Didn't Vlad marry the Heroes cheerleader?
Yes.
Yes. And Hayden Panettiere.
You can't kill her.
Mike White, Cowboy Great, 29. I'm so sorry, fellas.
White Lotus.
Tell you this. Right before we go to break, dead on this day, still dead, in the year 2022.
Oh, no.
The man who drummed his heart out on my hero, Taylor Hawkins.
Oh, no. It's been 2 years.
Five.
Stay hard, Taylor.
Three, two, and.
Stay hard.
Did you text Dave today?
And he left no air.
I will right now.
No drumming, son.
Bye, son.
Broadcasting live from the TXU Energy Mothership at Victory Park, hard by the AAC. This is Sports.
Here's Dave.
Hi, Dave.
Hello. Happy Monday, everyone.
Mm-hmm.
So, Sean Diddy Combs has been in all kinds of legal trouble stemming from alleged sexual assaults and allegations of sex trafficking.
Sex
having
crimes.
Young women flown to recording sessions or parties and then being plied with drugs and alcohol and then having untoward things happen to them.
Mm-hmm.
And he also evidently has a weird working relationship with a lot of his employees. He likes to shower in front of employees and do weird
he's
stuff.
Just a guy
he's just
that
a
got a lot of money,
guy.
Started dipping his toes into the weird waters, very Louis C.K. like, what can I get away with? And then just kept doing it because nobody called him out on it, and now it's time to pay the piper.
You remember the Chappelle sketch where he was sending his assistant out to get all the finest Laotian breast milk.
Yeah, yeah.
So, this has been following him for a while, but it seems it's perhaps coming to roost at long last as Homeland Security agents raided both of his homes.
Mm-hmm.
One of them in Los Angeles, in Holmby Hills, which is where the Playboy Mansion used to be,
mm-hmm.
and also in Miami. And so Homeland Security has not provided details as to what exactly they were looking for, but they just said it was part of an ongoing investigation. And Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department was also on the scene out there in L.A. And I guess there's footage of agents taking items out of these residences to corroborate these allegations of sexual assaults and sex trafficking.
I wonder if he's had time to clear the area.
Yeah, I don't know. And evidently the L.A. mansion is also associated with his production company. So Bad Boy Films. So I don't know if he has a studio built into his home. Surely he does. But there's probably a lot of materials related to his production company.
Not the best name for your company either if people are investigating you, like Raper Studios or something like that.
Yeah, that would have that'd be the
that
only
taken.
One worse.
Right.
And the attorney for a couple of the supposed victims of Sean Combs issued a statement saying, "We always support law enforcement when it seeks to prosecute those that have violated the law.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully this is the beginning of a process that will hold Mr. Combs responsible for his depraved conduct."
Mm-hmm.
So we will be following that on E! News for you. As I'm sure you probably have heard by now, Blake Lively has apologized to Kate Middleton. the Princess of Wales.
What did Blake Lively say? Was she one of the, like, needling paparazzi types of, like, we deserve to see her?
No, it wasn't that. So she was just trying, because you know how she's married to, what's his nuts?
Deadpool.
Yeah,
Ryan Reynolds.
Ryan Reynolds. And she...
His name is not Deadpool.
Or what's his nuts.
She and what's his nuts mm-hmm. are very entrepreneurial. They both have tons of businesses.
Yeah.
And they're also very snarky online, and they like to capitalize on the meme or the
right.
the social conversation of the moment. And so when there was the whole Photoshop thing, when Kate Middleton posted the heavily edited image for Britain's Mother's Day, where her kid had three arms and
right.
she had six toes or whatever.
It was like her and Abby and Brittany, and they decided to try to sell it off as normal.
Right. So at the time, Blake Lively, she was trying to coattail on that, and she posted an edited photo where she said, I'm excited to share this new photo I just took to announce our four new Betty Buzz products, which is like a alcoholic drink that she is pimping. She says, now you know why I've been MIA, again referencing mm-hmm. that no one had seen where Kate Middleton was. And so the edited photo that Lively was in shows her sitting poolside, and she's holding a can of Betty Booze, but her thumb is unusually large, and there's like a lemon that's floating over her head, and uh-huh. her chair is in two parts, and
yep,
you know, so
it's all funny till that
until
cancer report comes out, huh, Blake?
Yeah, then we find out that Kate Middleton has cancer, and that's why she can't edit photographs. And so
Blake, I don't know if that's the case.
And so Blake Lively said, I'm sure no one cares today, but I feel like I have to acknowledge this. I made a silly post around the Photoshop fails frenzy, and oh man, that post has me mortified today. I'm sorry. Sending love and well wishes to all, always. So.
Way to go, Blake. Way
sure
to go.
Sure, the royal family is relieved that Blake Lively
yes.
has taken her comeuppance.
We need to hear from her.
For such poor taste. Let's turn to movie news and the box office over the weekend. Did anybody see Ghostbusters Frozen Empire? Does anybody have any interest whatsoever?
Nope.
You know, coming from a Ghostbusters family, not only my own, the current family, but I went and saw, you know, the early movies with my dad and mom, I do believe. Kids have been indoctrinated into the Ghostbusters world via me, and we've seen the female reboot with Melissa McCarthy, cast of other characters.
Which, in this universe, doesn't exist, by the way.
Right. Saw the most recent one, the Paul
Afterlife,
Rudd. Paul
yes.
Rudd and is it Carrie Coon?
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is a sequel to that.
Yes. And the kid, Finn Wolfhard, the kid from Stranger Things.
Yes.
I enjoyed the hell out of the last one, and I will go see this new one, but I've not seen it.
Yes. So word on the street is that this one is bigger and more fun even than Ghostbusters Afterlife. And it did, just by a skosh, out-earn Ghostbusters Afterlife. So Afterlife earned $44 million in its first weekend. Frozen Empire, $45.2 million in its debut weekend. Critics don't really like it, 43% on Rotten Tomatoes, but a B-plus from the cinema score, the audience score.
I mean, what are you expecting here, right?
And that bumped Dune Part 2 down to the number 2 spot. $17.6 million, so the total in North America for Dune after 3 weeks, $233 million, $574 million globally.
God, this ruins your prediction, though, that Dune 2 was going to be number one for the rest of the year.
Yeah, I was banging the table on that.
Let me tell you something, Davidson.
Kung Fu Panda dropped to third, and the other new release over the weekend, Immaculate, with Sydney Sweeney.
Sup, slut.
Where she plays the nun?
Yeah, she plays a nun who gets possessed or is chased by a demon or something.
Yeah, there's like a devil in her.
Gives birth to a baby antichrist.
Yes.
I don't know.
Yeah, she has two antichrists in her uterus.
So it opened in fourth place, only $5.3 million for Immaculate.
Boy, she's had a couple of flops.
Stinkers.
Like that.
But she will always have those up tops to fall forward.
Well,
on.
Dave, I don't know floppers. If that's what she wants to be known for. Mm. Although she doesn't go anywhere, and she's starting to catch heat for it. Every single photo shoot, public appearance, it is knocker city.
Yeah, it's jugs. All the cleavage.
Right.
Speaking of floppers.
Yeah, I don't.
How do I move it. There?
Why didn't McLaren have his bachelor party
yeah,
in
what
knocker
an idiot.
City?
Nothing wrong slumming with that. It in Arlington.
Speaking of floppers, Scarlett Johansson floppers. Has yeah. been tied to a new project that makes this project that it was already very interesting even more interesting. She is now linked to the new Jurassic World movie.
Mm, I'm interested. Mm.
So dinosaurs and Scarlett Johansson.
So,
I mean, maybe it'll be ScarJo and Sydney Sweeney.
I highly doubt.
And they can fight the dinosaurs with their boobies.
Holy cow.
N.
There's only one way to defeat this T-Rex. Our boobies.
Friday.
They just take their tops off and the T-Rex just is frozen in his tracks.
Right.
Can't even believe what he's seeing.
Yeah.
Yeah, so as we mentioned before, it's already set for release July 2nd next summer.
Next summer?
Yeah.
And they're just now casting it?
Yeah. They,
this is a dinosaur. It takes years to make.
They don't even know what they're doing.
What plot line can they have that has not already been explored in the dinosaur world? Like, what do you... seriously.
Motorboat a dinosaur?
Again, we're moving on from boobs. We're moving away. We're moving away from Knocker City just for a second.
Like, come on, Ham, but be better.
What can they possibly do that's original that would get people interested, other than cooler dinosaurs?
Dinosaurs in New York City.
We've done.
I mean,
that.
That's like King Kong, right?
Dinosaurs in Paris.
Just like, ooh, quit naming cities.
Like having a baguette in a
flower mound.
Or like
a sidewalk cafe.
Like a dinosaur on a high school basketball team.
Yeah, like Teen Wolf.
Yeah.
Sure.
All right, we got to get to this last one.
We're going to run the picket fence
one
with
more,
this stegosaurus.
One more. As Rebel Wilson, she had previously mentioned, because she is publicizing her new tell-all memoir, Rebel Rising, which is supposed to come out April 2nd. And she's talked in the past saying that a massive a-hole that she worked with had hired a crisis PR team and had started sending her threats saying that they wanted to stop her from releasing her memoir because she was dedicating a whole chapter to this person. So she came out today and revealed that that person is Sacha Baron Cohen.
No, I don't want to know. I know. Why he's bad?
Yeah, so she said, I will not be bullied or silenced with high-priced lawyers or PR crisis managers. The a-hole that I'm talking about in one chapter of my book is Sacha Baron Cohen. And so she says when they were working on The Brothers Grimsby, a 2016 film, that he was telling her every day, just go naked. It'll be funny. Remember in Borat when I did that naked scene, it was hilarious. And then so...
He's got a point there.
Then so the last day of filming... She says that she thought that she had won the argument because they had a body double do the naked scene. And so she's like, okay, so he saw that I wasn't going to do it and they worked around it. But then they shot a scene after that. The final scene that they shot on the movie, she says, she claimed that Baron asked her to, quote, stick your finger up my blank.
Uh-huh.
And then when she pointed out that it wasn't in the script... He said, look, I'll just pull down my pants. You just stick your finger there. It'll be a really funny bit.
And she didn't like that?
She thought that it was demeaning and disgusting. And it was against her principles. And so through a spokesman
today... But he was
today,
doing it for the sake of comedy.
Yeah, he just was trying to do funny bit.
Okay, well, that's Sacha Baron Cohen. I hold nothing against him.
So through a spokesperson, he said today...
That's quite a convenient out you've given
Lando,
him.
Lando, get in here.
While we appreciate the importance of speaking out, these demonstrably false claims are directly contradicted by extensive detailed evidence, including documents, film footage, and eyewitness accounts.
Mm-hmm.
During and after the production of the Brothers Grimsby. So
she just dreamed that he said, as one can make that mistake quite often.
Right.
Would you please do this
stick
to
your
me?
Finger.
Yeah. Ew.
Ew.
Where doo-doo's made.
Ooh, indeed. All right, Dave, thank you very much. It's not where it's made.
It's around the corner, actually.
Well, it's...
right, it is around the corner. All right.
Here he is.
Dave.
So according to a memo from the city of Dallas on Friday, the levels of E. coli remained high on March 21st, 1 week after the spill into White Rock began. So as of Friday, E. coli levels were still dangerously high.
What have we done? What have we done to the city of Plano? What kind of reparations have we given them? Have we set up internment camps? What is going on? How do we punish the city of Plano for doo-dooing all over the city of Dallas?
I don't know. We have not crafted our response yet. However, as of Sunday, Dallas officials restored water recreation activities at White Rock Lake. They said that water samples were within normal pre-incident levels mm-hmm. by Sunday. And so fishing, rowing, and boating activities were able to resume. And swimming for humans is not allowed, but the yeah. White Rock dog
the fish
park
are still allowed.
Yeah.
Where dogs were once again allowed to swim.
What if the fish get huge?
Like eating all that doo-doo?
Golly.
So, I don't know how we are going to make this right with Plano. Mm-hmm. I don't know if we're going to seek retribution or maybe levy hefty fines.
How about this? None of their football or basketball teams next year are eligible for the playoffs.
Why are you so...
I think you need to write...
Oh, I'm sorry. You don't live here.
Why are you coming in so hot?
You don't consume the water.
Well, Mr. Joe Plano didn't ask for that to happen. It was an accident.
I'm sorry.
He didn't control.
Well...
He filled up the doo-doo pipes so much that they burst.
Yeah.
Joe Plano is at fault.
You're yeah. punishing the kids for the dues of their fathers, though.
No, they're complicit, too. Everyone
yeah,
is.
I think you need to write a strongly worded email to the UIL.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's the only penalty
something
that makes
needs
sense.
To happen. Maybe internment camps is a little aggressive.
It feels a lot aggressive. Just relax.
I think every family in Plano needs to dig a latrine in their backyard and doo-doo in that latrine for a month.
1 month. There you go. You have to take care of your own waste for 1 month, and you're not allowed to go in toilets. And if you do, there'll be a camera down there, and your toilet will explode on demand.
What about for the elderly people?
Or if you flush...
It's their fault for being so old.
Or right, we just need to block all sewage lines.
Yeah.
So if they flush a toilet, it will just... rise back up into their house.
Right.
Right.
Yes, doo-doo.
The Fort Worth Zoo is moving their baby gorilla, Jamila. Now, if you remember, she was born via emergency C-section earlier this year. She was born on January 5th, prematurely. Her 33-year-old mother, Sakani, had a serious blood pressure condition that forced them to do the emergency C-section. But because it was a C-section and not a natural birth, Sakani did not have interest in caring for baby Jamila.
Mm-hmm.
And so then the staff attempted two other troop members there in Fort Worth, Gracie and Winifred, and neither of them showed much interest in being a surrogate mother.
So the...
Yes?
Millions of years of evolution within the ape community has, or gorilla, I'm sorry. I don't know if I'm
Apes or gorillas? Okay. Or gorillas or apes?
Go with primate.
Okay, thank you.
The primate community.
But it is so in their DNA that if they don't have a natural birth, that they don't feel close to the newborn, they can't tell. It's like, that's not mine.
Well,
anyway, got to go.
They said that when during natural birth, the body releases hormones that then allows the mother to bond with the infant.
You would think that she'd be able to sniff that kid out, though. Like, that's mine.
Yeah, that came from inside there.
Right. It just so happens it didn't come out the way that we intended, but clearly the stitches that I have on my tummy, that's the other thing. How do you keep stitches in a gorilla?
You put a cone on their head.
How do you...
Man, I love this. This is all good.
Whoa, so
you just blew my mind.
Wait.
Are you a wizard?
Would a gorilla allow a cone to be on his or her head? Like, a dog can't get it off. How long would a gorilla take to take
the cone off?
The opposable
thumbs, they would rip that off right away.
Yeah. And you would think that the gorilla's partner, if she did have a natural birth, if the baby was too big and they had to stitch her up a little bit, you know?
Uh-huh.
Like, you think that the gorilla dad would be happy with the C-section.
Right.
And then he would be like, hey, this is your kid.
It's not all stretched out.
Yeah, and, you know, you still got it, baby. You're looking good.
You're a wizard.
The gorilla bikini.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they, at the Fort Worth Zoo, they ended up putting baby Jamila on, like, gorilla baby Tinder.
Yeah.
And the Cleveland Zoo swiped right.
Yeah.
And so the Cleveland Zoo is going to take baby Jamila. They're hoping that one of their adult females will take her as their own.
What if they just...
And integrate her into the troop.
What if they stick it in the enclosure, right?
Whoa.
Uh-huh. And the mom walks out there and looks at it, and or moms, plural, whoever they have in there, and they're all looking at it, and they're like, what do you even... Don't try this. This is a scam. This isn't any of ours, and they punt it right out.
Wrong.
All right, I'm going to save ballpark food for tomorrow, I think, because I do want to get to this one.
No reaction at all.
This is the best. I'm loving this whole thing.
I want to get to this one.
First Plano.
I need to know from the Cleveland Zoo if this works. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't need them to say, yeah, we'll take it, and then we don't hear any reports, and then Jamila is in a shallow grave in the gorilla enclosure.
Right. Right. I'm got my eye on you, Cleveland.
All right, so everybody is already tired of election talk, right?
So tired.
No, I love elections.
But we have all the way until November to listen to it.
Make it stop.
And certainly there are people with their penance for either candidate for the presidential election.
Yeah, in this climate that we live in, I think that everybody's just kind of neutral.
But yes, what if there was another choice?
Mm-hmm. Interested.
So a 35-year-old 7th grade math teacher from Birdville ISD, also an Army veteran, much like Orlando in there.
Ah, yes. President Lando.
He has legally changed his name. His name is now literally anybody else. And he is trying to get on the ballot as an independent candidate.
Okay.
So they call him in this story Mr. Else. Because his first name is literally, his middle name is anybody.
Mr. Else.
And his last name is Else. And in the story, in the morning news, or actually in Channel 8, WFAA, you can see his driver's license that says literally anybody else as his name. So he has filed with the Federal Election Commission.
Federal interest.
And he's trying to get signatures to get on the November ballot in Texas as an independent candidate. He says, I'm not delusional. This will be very hard to do, but it's not impossible. My hope is to have Donald Trump, Joe Biden, and then literally anybody else right underneath. I really want there to be an outlet for folks like me who are just so fed up with this constant power grab between two parties that has no benefit for the common person.
Oh, God love you.
What a waste of time.
So In Texas, an application to be on the ballot as an independent candidate must be submitted with a petition and filed on or before May 13th. And so that petition must have 113,151 signatures. I don't know how many he has at this point.
Yeah.
And they have to be registered voters who did not vote in either presidential primary. So he's threading a very specific needle here. But other states also have similar requirements and deadlines. So it's doubtful, even if he can get on the Texas ballot, I don't know if he's has the resources to get on other ballots. So he's going to have to hope for success as a write-in candidate. And I'm sure there will be people who don't even know he exists that will write in literally anybody else.
Right.
So how big is the group of us that don't vote in either presidential primary?
I mean, a lot.
Oh, I think
because the turnout was very low in the primaries.
Yeah, it's terrible.
It's got to be like 90%, right?
Yeah. So, yeah. So if he can find those people, and he will probably be out there on Friday before the Sweet 16 matches.
Mm-hmm.
He has he's been spotted outside of Stars games and Mavericks games, trying to get people to sign his petition to get literally anybody else on the ballot in November.
I'm still voting for Lando. Right?
Yeah, let's make it happen.
Yeah, you're the guy that we need.
Five-star Lando.
Not just want, need. Yes, he is the closest thing we have to a five-star general here at the ticket.
Weed is legal now, Corby.
God bless you.
Making that change.
God bless you. All right.